Good afternoon. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Yes, ma'am. You're welcome to today's forum.
Thank you.
How are you doing now? How's your body?
Sorry?
How is your health? How is your health?
Much better now.
Okay.
Actually, we had something outside, so you know that caused food poisoning.
Okay.
So, you know, I wasn't well, yeah.
It's okay.
But then I was like, I'm committed, so I have to, you know, come and speak. So, yeah, that's okay.
That's good. So, you're welcome. Can we proceed for today's meeting? Okay.
Okay.
Yeah. Welcome to Big Week with Sasere. Over the years, we have seen a series of bias and crisis as gender inequality has been taking place, especially in Africa here. Gender inequality is like a cancer disease that has spread all over the body of Africa. I don't think there is any culture in Africa that did not elevate men than women in any when it comes to leadership and fear, even starting from home. Although I am a Christian, and I know that biblically, God also instructs women to be submissive. And even when through a journey as well, is a very good thing that one must also submit. But so that there will be understanding. But when it comes to leadership, I believe that leadership includes leadership requires skill, experience, and other likes. So for this reason, we have women like the present Director General for World Trade Organization. Is a woman and she's from Nigeria here. She's an African. So if we are to say that because she's a woman, she's not supposed to be in that way. We don't know many things that we might have lose. You know, we have Queen Elizabeth of England. At least by next year, she'll complete 70 years on her throne as a queen. So we have women that are making impact. We have women that have made impact. Even you, Dr. Tamana Kosla, you're a woman. You have taught and served as an assistant professor of a university in which even some men are even struggling to become a lecturer, just common lecturer. So we should not in our society, we should appreciate. So that is why this discussion has to take place. Now we will not say women in politics, because politics are the major leadership sectors of the whole world presently now. So to you now, Dr. Kosla, what can you say about women in politics by the virtue of your experience, the women in politics, both participation and the decision making? So thank you. Over to you, ma'am.
Yeah. Hi. So basically, what I would like to start with is, the suffragist movement. You know, and women during the 18th century were so desperate, you know, the blacks as well as the women in America and UK, they were so desperate for suffrage to be given to them that they struggled for it. There were many empowered women during that time, you know, many single women who were fighting for the rights of women. And till the time in the 1919 they achieved suffrage, they did not stop. So I guess suffrage is extremely important, and you know that importance of it has to be realized by women right now, and they should struggle hard. In India, for example, our women parliamentarians are struggling hard for 33% reservations for women. The best part is that in Africa, Rwanda and South Africa have already got 50% reservations for women. I guess in Nigeria, it's 35%, but the participation is around 6% of women. In India, it's 10%, in China, it's 9%. So it's pretty bad, you know, like, but then many of the Scandinavian countries have set up a parameter, you know, like, for example, you know, they have a woman cabinet, Finland,
yes.
You know, and in New Zealand, you know, we have a very empowered woman who just gave birth to a child and, you know, she was like back to work immediately and, you know, like amazing, you know, that kind of a thing. So the basic dilemma is, should women act like men when they enter politics, or should they act like women? I guess they should act like persons, you know, personhood of, because, you know, if they act like men, they will be criticized for that, you know, if they kind of get into loot and killing and corruption, etc. And many of our women politicians in India, my experience is that, you know, they are very, they are more men-like rather than women. But as far as women are concerned, then they'll be considered to be soft and, you know, like they would be given softer roles, you know, like, for example, child and women and child and, you know, those kind of things rather than defense. So, you know, so hardly you'll find women who have been given defense as a portfolio or, you know, home ministry. Despite the fact that home ministry is women's role in the society, home is the place where women are supposed to be supposed to set themselves up. So yeah. So now I would like to say state certain politics. Why do we need women in politics? We need women in politics because women are subsequently they face oppression. They are exploited. Exploited in the sense that, you know, there is that oppression occurs through a steady process of transfer of labor from one gender to another. So, for example, women, through their biological aspect, they give birth and they provide labor. This is the Marxist feminist case, we say that. And they say that, you know, social rules about what work is, who does what for whom, how work is compensated, and the social process by which the results of work are appropriated, operate to enact relations of power and inequality. So, Christine Delphi's example, for example, would say, again, a Marxist feminist looks at it looks at the whole process of racially marked groups also within the ambit of marginalization as such, you know. So it's like in US, a shamefully large proportion of what I was trying to say is that racially discriminated people were also included within feminism. So feminism takes care of LGBTQ community, it takes care of racially biased community, and it takes care of old, aged, able, physically marked, every kind of people who have been affected by any kind of discrimination. So this is the whole process which feminism looks into. So marginalization is perhaps the most difficult form of oppression. a whole category of people is expelled from useful participation. So women, for example, women and many other racially marked groups are marginalized. Muslims, for example, you know, they are marginalized in US after 9/11. And Jews obviously are. Anti-Semitism is majorly a issue which has to be looked into. And so liberalism has traditionally aimed at rational autonomous agents to equal citizenship. So early bourgeois liberalism explicitly excluded from citizenship all those whose reasons were questionable or not fully developed. It's not so now, but the fact is that women remain nowhere in the political sector. It's very few. For example, in US too, hardly any women is there in parliaments. And this causes a lot of distress to many women. Now, thankfully, one of them is there, Kamala Harris. And, you know, now she's also, because of ill health of the president, you know, she is taking over as the president for a certain while, you know. And so that's very interesting, you know, like a phenomenon. And our generation, women, if we do not raise our voice against political discrimination of women, then who will, you know? So, then the powerlessness. Another thing about this thing is that they're powerless. So they are powerless. Till the time power is not there with women, nothing can happen. You know, men have ruled over women for centuries because they had power over them, sexual as well as monetary, as well as political. So all social as well. So a new civil society has to be created where women have to So then violence. Women repeatedly face rapes. They face, you know, for example, in Nigeria, you have Boko Haram, you know, these kind of groups which bring bad name to the country, which is a bad thing, you know. And politics, because it's being run by men, they do all these things. Any different group in India too, you know, you have these things, you know, happening, you know, different groups indulging into women being seen as a softer gender to be suppressed. And violence in the form of sexual harassment, you know, and women, for example, entering politics, facing harassment. And if she's too loud or too well spoken, she's taken to be very easy. She's taken to be a difficult woman. While if a male speaks in a certain way, he is seen to be he's considered to be a great person, you know, like he's very articulate and all that. And if a woman does that, she is not articulate. So she's just being nosy, you know, if she's just being picky. So that is all. So now how should we deal with these ideas? The best thing would be, you know, how to get men and women together. Now, one of the prominent thinkers, Iris Marian Young, would say, political philosopher, she would say that, you know, you should have a basis of relationality. Now, what is relationality? Relationality is, for example, there's an old man and there is a young person, you know. Both are disabled, or for example, both forget the disabled part, they are anti-nuke in their perspective. So both of them can come together. So one is a male, one is a female. That's the difference. One is old, one is young. That's the difference. But the similarity is that they both are anti-new policy. So, you know, like, so the concept of relationality needs to be understood. And that way, people across genders, across ages, across able-bodied and disabled bodies, everybody will come together. And we need to build a world where which is simpler to understand, and you know, where a cosmopolitan world, which is a local in nature. Local means that the world is coming closer and it's local in nature, and as well as global and local, making it into global. And okay, so what do you? One second. This is my PhD thesis. Yeah. So, you know, many of the thinkers would say that, you know, group representation is extremely important. You know, so women should be given rights as a group. And that has been recognized in many countries, you know, though, for example, Arabian countries, too, their level of political participation has increased, so has in Africa. India is still lagging behind because it's a huge country. We are a democracy. We should have had reservation till now. We are having patriarchal forces which are making it hard for women's movement to have a reservation in parliament, which is essential because, you know, till the time, for example, women, men have elite support, they have voter bias, and they have institutional, and women have to face institutional sexism. So these two, three things are there which women have to face by themselves. So group representation is must. First of all, self-organization of group members, institutional mechanism and public resources so as to support self-organization of group members. So as I said, that monetarily women are suppressed. So when the women should self-organize themselves, for example, in India, we had a group called Seva, you know, of Ila Bhatt. And she, in the 70s, started a movement called Seva. And it provided economic independence to women. So now we need a movement where we want political independence for women, so that women are able to come forward without any fear and take part. You know, people say that men would be men. Then, you know, like, what kind of a society are we? Are we a barbaric society where men are going to just, you know, like, so these things are not there. And then secondly, group analysis, which takes group concerns into consideration. Group analysis and group generation of policy proposals is institutionalized context where decision makers are obliged to show that their deliberation have taken group perspective into consideration. So group considerations need to be taken care of, and many groups need to be formed so that they can participate in political structure in a decent manner. Then third and the most important thing is veto power. Now, whatever power, the any policy which affects women should be given the power to the woman. You know, they should have the veto power. You know, the way it's in Security Council, you have veto power. Here in India, or be it in Nigeria, women should have, for example, if circumcision or something, you know, women should have power, not men. You know, and they should veto if anything which is against women is being passed. So yeah, so this is the whole thing. And while we would say that multiculturalism and feminism are allies in academic politics, but not in the real world. So men have to realize it, that you know they are doing something not very great, because you know, if we have to reach to the skies, you know, we have to reach to the spaces, we can't leave behind the women. They have to come together. So yeah, and unnecessary, you know, in politics, for example, there would be unnecessary scrutiny of women, you know, unnecessary surveillance, you know, so those kind of things are there. Then women doubt about policy themselves as candidates. So what are the lacunes, you know, which women face? So firstly, women doubt about policy themselves as candidates. You know, they themselves do not have the confidence. The best part about India is that, you know, we passed a bill in 1993, which was the 73rd Amendment. And it gave, because since you'll understand better, we are a federal polity. And so it gave the right to the women at the lowest level in the villages to reservations for them. So they performed extremely well. And we have a case study, then why not are women being given chance in the parliament at the national level? So the best part was that women were not just rubber stamps, you know, they're like their husbands telling them, and many people said, you know, they doubted that, you know, women would not be able to participate because their husbands are going to guide them, and you know, like they'll be just rubber stamps. But it didn't happen. They did not listen to them, and they passed their own judgments about issues and, you know, all those kind of things. Then secondly, rampant sexism, women are not welcomed in this. So childcare, etc., you know, these things are which prevent women from performing good work. And, you know, because they have to manage the house as well as outside. And, you know, so the husbands have to be looked after, like children. So those kind of things are there. And then in Ireland, for example, you know, you have a policy where inspiring, equipping and informing women to run for, you know, they are like training women. So you have to train your children from the childhood itself, women as well as boys and girls, how to, because politics is the sphere where, you know, you can discuss and change the world. That is the only place, be it bureaucracy or be it the state. So that's where the world can change itself in a substantial way. Cyprus missed, there is strengthening the capacity of civil society and the women's movement to effectively advocate for gender priority in decision making. So, this is what Cyprus has in mind when it says about this thing. And, I'll just ask any questions.
It's okay. First, I want to appreciate you for everything you have said since, and I learned so much. I hope you can hear me very well, Miss Dr. Kusla. I don't know. I guess this is Mr. Wilson joining us. So I would like him to ask his question.
Women running for political places. So what we need now is giving veto rights to women.
It's and, okay. Sorry, Dr. Kusla. I appreciate the speech. So, and I guess I possibly I have to switch to another meeting now. Yeah. But before then, I would like
okay.
I would like Mr. Wilson to ask his question. I guess this is Mr. Wilson, Eric. I hope you can hear me.
Yes, I can hear you clearly.
Okay, I would like to contribute your view as regard women in politics just in 2 minutes maximum, please. Ask your question.
Well, it's not much of a question. I think I heard clearly what she talked about. the essence of women being in politics. It's very essential in a country where we have both male and female. Even in the Bible, there are some roles given to women. So in politics as well, they shouldn't be ruled out totally.
And I think it's another a wise thing, one. Another thing, any religion which is questioning women and asking them to be submissive should be questioned. And you know, like, because religion has to change with time. Every religion, you know, they have to change with time. And you know, like, everything is not the same every time. So it should be questioned. And you know, like, because we are constitutional democracies, you know, we have our constitutions. So religion needs to be questioned as much as possible. Secularism needs to enter the world, which was said during the Renaissance, way back in the 18th century. So that would help in progress in the political sphere as well of women as well as men who are from poor sections. You know, for example, a poor man and woman would be in the same situation. You know, that is what is relationality. You know, like, everybody is tied with some relation. You and I must be having some kind of a relation. You know, we can share certain issues. You might be different in some, I might be different in some, but we will share some. Yeah.
Let me ask you this question. In the area of India, how is the ratio women in politics? Are they allowed to participate?
Of course.
What ratio?
The issue is that, you know, there is a lot of institutional sexism. Women do not have so much money that they, you know, a lot of money is required to, you know, enter the political sphere. You have to be backed by a lot of people, and which is very difficult for women because they, you know, during the peak ages of 30 to 50, they're managing their houses, and money is an issue. Who's going to sponsor them? And they have to start from the local levels, and you know, after studies, you know, they get married and everything, so that's a problem. But so India also has only 10% reservation, 10% participation of women in parliament. So women are like, you know, like, only women movement has been asking for 33 reservations for women. In fact, many are asking for 50% reservations because women hold 50% sky. So why not give them the right kind of patriarchal and backward, are asking that this reservation will only suppress men. But that complex should go away, that, you know, women entering the political sphere is going to make them move away from main politics. You know, why that fear? So, yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much, Dr. Kusla. I'm recording this, and I will try and work on the video to be more perfect. Okay. I hope you can hear me.
Yes, I can hear you, brother.
Mr. Rere, I appreciate your coming. Although I don't believe it, so you surprised me. I appreciate your coming. We still have more things to develop more about this. So, but I just want to ask for the excuse because I need to switch for another meeting. So I hope we have more time and more development to plan this very well, so that you can be able to discuss more effectively as regards both to develop Nigeria here and over there in India. So, and then I want to inform you, Mr. Rizin, Dr. Kusla Tamana is with us here in Nigeria. She is ready to lay down a legacy of the experience. So we have been appreciating her. She is passionate. In fact, one of the things is that she told me something this morning. So that's why even when we say that women are this, women are that, we should appreciate them, because I guess even if some men, because let me be open. She told me that she's not feeling fine. And with the situation of what she told me, I don't even believe that we can hold this. And you see the way she has been talking is like nothing has ever happened to her at all. So those are the things that we should appreciate and even see that potential in women, that yes, they have that strength men have power, while women have strength. So
yeah,
yeah, that's the reality.
Absolutely.
So once again, I appreciate Dr. Tamara Kusla, and I appreciate you for coming and to have this. So by next time, we have more development regarding. Then I will reach you privately, Mr. Wilson. So to look forward as regarding discussion. So on Friday, we'll be having another person as well. I believe there will be a development on that. So thank you very much for today. Thank you very much. I appreciate it. Thank you, Dr. Tamara Kusla. Thank you, Mr. Wilson.
Most welcome, Michael.
So namaste once again.
Namaste.
All right.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you. Have a wonderful time.
Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, much a pleasure here. Yeah, thank you so much too.